if we are not practicing right spiritual practice, which really is full stop in the wow, then we're practicing increasing our continuity fear. We're practicing turning reality into an abyss and truth into a threat to cast us into the abyss. Okay? This is the truth. This is a fact. This is a fact. A fact. This is what I've discovered. This puts everything in the right context. We're either practicing evaporating continuity fear or making continuity fear worse. One of the two. One of the two. When we make continuity fear worse, literally, we see truth as a severe threat to cast us into reality, which we see as an abyss of annihilation. Therefore, anyone who is here to try to share the truth, we see them as a threat, and we reject them very severely. This is what's been going on throughout history. This is what takes place here. So it's a requirement here for everyone to do right spiritual practice. It's not an option, it's a requirement. Right spiritual practice is full stop in the wow. This is the root practice. There are many elaborations that have like skateboard tricks, but we don't need to do all those elaborations. Just as the Dharma kings say, just sit quiet, be still. Don't assess yourself. Don't analyze progress. We've gone over and over this. It's easy to get this. You just sit and commit it to just doing nothing for right now, because the information you get is so shocking. You feel most secure when you're not doing anything. So it's a question, the right spiritual practice, how do you feel secure enough to glimpse the truth and get used to seeing the truth? And how do you feel secure if it's sitting here doing nothing? Not planning to do anything, not thinking about doing anything, not imagining to do anything. You're just, wow. That is so intense. I just want to sit here. Like watching Niagara Falls. Don't you like this kind of, like, sit down? Let me just sit down and be quiet here. Because the roar, the intensity is so strong. Well, the intensity of truth for us seems to be very shocking and strong. And I can tell you that when you do this practice, you continue to progress. And so, it's an obligation here. It's an essential obligation. If I look at the world, what I see are those simply derelicts who refuse to practice and are totally threatened, intimidated, and fearful of any sharing of truth, and have a drastic fear of reality, as they feel reality is their annihilation, destruction. That's this world. And people think this world's a great place. They think people are wonderful here. No, they're not. They are fanatics against truth, against the sharing of truth. Very fanatical. They see it as an extreme threat. They see it as extremely rude. The worst manners possible to share truth here. And this is a place like you want to, oh, yeah, I want to live here. I want to stay here. This is my home. Are you kidding? This is an insane asylum here. And the one cure is right spiritual practice. This right spiritual practice. Right spiritual practice. Buddha, Dharma, Sangha is in Buddhism. That's the answer, really, as far as, it doesn't have to be in Buddhism. It can be in anything right here, right now. You don't have to be aligned with any specific teaching or teacher, not necessarily. You can also. But the key is your own willingness to practice full stop in this wow. The wow this morning for me, I asked the Holy Spirit. I was stuck in a dream. I woke up. I was stuck. I was trying to find the right pants to wear, and I couldn't find anything. Someone said, you're going to go golfing like from now on. But so there's this huge warehouse full of golf clothes, golf pants, and I was looking for the right pants. I couldn't find the right pants. I had a shirt picked out, but I couldn't find the pants to match the shirt. Maybe the problem was the shirt, right? If I changed the shirt, then maybe I'd be able to find the pants to match. That's interesting. I hadn't thought of that, but I couldn't find the right pants, and it was really something. It took me. I was stuck. Then I asked the Holy Spirit for help when I woke up, and I said, Holy Spirit, give me a practice for today. And right away, it came that I said, Holy Spirit, you just ruined everything. You just ruined everything. I said, huh. Everything is ruined. Okay, now instead of going into thinking or reacting, panicking, oh, that's terrible. This, what I just do? Wow. I just said, wow. That's it. So everything is ruined. Holy Spirit, I said, you're going to ruin everything for me. I saw that. You're going to ruin everything for me. Okay. Now, I didn't say that's great, or I didn't say that's terrible. So full stop in the wow. We don't polarize. Okay. We don't agree and we don't disagree. We don't agree and we don't disagree. So there's really nothing else in this world to do except to gain proficiency in right spiritual practice. There's nothing else to do here, actually, that is any value at all. In terms of our focus and activity, pragmatically, we take care of our existence, so to speak here. But in terms of what's essential, what's our essential discipline? This is it. It has to be it. And people, the characteristics of this world is everybody avoids it. And they keep waiting for despair to transform them so they don't have to do it. That will never happen. It's unavoidable. Spiritual discipline is something that is totally unavoidable. You think you avoid it through dying, you don't. That's why people want to keep dying. They think it to them it's much more preferable and easy to fall dead than it is to do this spiritual practice. Well, of course it seems easy, except you get reborn. Go through all of that again and again and again and again and again and again. As long as you avoid the right spiritual practice, you'll continue to be reborn, transmigrate. You'll simply transmigrate. So you think it's easy to fall down dead. Yeah, but what are you falling into? You're falling into another birth is what you're doing. We're all just falling into another birth. Some transmigration in some realm. I saw this grasshopper yesterday. It's a very large grasshopper, huge. It was a leaf grasshopper. And its body was shaped exactly like a leaf. And its markings on its body, look at it, you'd think it was a leaf. It was amazing. Maybe you'll be reborn as a grasshopper, leaf grasshopper. anyway, transmigrating. You're just falling into another birth. That's all. You're not really falling dead at all. You're just falling into another cycle of misery. Hoping that this liberates you from the necessity to wake up from this dream. It doesn't. Death does not liberate anyone. They talk about, let's not get off track. Let's stay right in the wow of this. It's already intense. So everything is ruined. I said, Holy Spirit, you're going to ruin everything. Totally ruin everything. I saw it. I just wowed it. My foot is hurting because I tied my shoes too tight. Usually I just suffer the whole day with it, but right now I'm not going to suffer that, even when I'm taping. So I just wowed this. The Holy Spirit, you're going to ruin everything, everything, thingness. You're going to ruin thingness for me. You're going to completely ruin thingness for me. Okay, now what did I do? Go through this. This is very crucial. Instead of saying, trying to say, oh, how great. Thank you so much, Holy Spirit. Instead of trying to go into this positive vein of grasping it and chasing after it and all this mental activity of, oh, that's exactly what I want. Oh, that's wonderful. Thank you. I didn't do that. And instead of saying, what? You're going to ruin everything? That's horrible. That's terrible. Oh, I can't stand that. I didn't go there either. You don't go towards the positive, and you don't go toward the negative in the wow. You realize that you're oscillating between positive and negative, like, oh, maybe that's great, and maybe that's terrible. You don't go either direction, though. You don't take any direction at all. You just sit in the now, here in the wow. Just sit in the wow. Like, wow, that's really going to stir up a lot. You realize this is really stirring it up. So let me just then sit here quietly. Yeah. My mind quiet, not taking any position on it at all, not pro or con, not pro or con. The wow is neither pro nor con. It is the wisdom of acknowledging there's both pros and cons oscillating here, and don't get into the oscillation. Just let it oscillate and it'll settle. As we get familiar with this, the oscillations settle down, because they say, well, at least I'm familiar with it. At least I've gotten familiar with this. And when we get familiar, that's when the oscillations die down. So do not get on that teeter-totter. You're just letting the teeter-totter go, but you're not on it. You're in the wow of just watching it, and you're not assessing anything. You're not saying, when's it going to slow down, counting out the oscillations, nothing. Just kind of hanging out like a parent with a child at a playground. The child's playing, and you're just sitting there just kind of monitoring everything as far as just make sure the child's okay, but you're not overly engaged in every little action that's taking place. It's like, wow, we're here at the park. We're enjoying the day. This is great. Just wow. Yes, the Holy Spirit's going to ruin everything. Absolutely. Absolutely. And yet, our reaction to this, again, we must, in a situation like this, we must just go into the wow of it, right? So the benefit of this, wowing this, is practicing the wow. The benefit is that we're able to get to these types of recognitions. The Holy Spirit's going to ruin everything for me. Going to ruin everything. And you say, wow. You don't say, okay, because that's affirmative. Wow is just neither affirmative nor negative. Okay? This is very important. I'm wearing my flip the script shirt here. Flip. flip. almost looks like a Tibetan prayer flag. What is it? It's blue, white, and red, yellow, red, green. Yeah. What's the last one? Yellow, green, red, green, red, yellow, something. I don't know. They're always in a certain order of Tibetan prayer flags. So, virtually everyone in this world is derelict. Virtually everyone. There are a few of us that are doing this practice, because this practice, we have to get to this ruination of everything. Holy Spirit's going to ruin everything for us. What does that mean? It's ruining thingness for us, right? But we're wise enough that we don't, when we this arises for us, we don't try to grasp it or throw it away. Neither. We just sit here quietly. Wow. And it is our capacity to practice in this way that we're able to entertain the Holy Spirit ruining everything for us. And this practice A big tree limb came down right on my practice area where I fall down dead. A big tree limb just fell down. Wow, that's quite extraordinary. It broke off and fell down. Right on my practice mat there. Exactly on my practice mat. That is really so extraordinary. This wow practice protects us from unscrupulousness in the world. It protects us. See, we can wow the insights that arise naturally from the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit gives us the insight. And we can wow it. So we don't form a dependency relationship with a guru, false gurus. They read books and they take in all this information, like everything is going to be ruined. They hear it, and then they can pronounce that in such a way that it, you know, shocks you, and then you go like, oh, that's so profound, yeah. And then you start to feel, first you feel the positive, that's great, thank you so much, and then you feel the negative, and then you don't know what to do with the negative. And the guru then says, well, the negative, that's not good. What's wrong with you, the negative? And then the guru then becomes this dependency device where you cling to the guru as the positive, and then you become dependent and you need them. You see, they foster this codependence, this need in this way. Those are the false gurus. There are many of those. And there will be many more. There are also true gurus. They're very different. So when we can just wow the insight for ourselves, we don't need the guru, the false guru. The real guru has our back in many, many ways. But we're not saying, oh my gosh, you know, you're so wonderful. You said this is so fantastic. Remember, there's an oscillation between positive and negative. So right away, you realize this is going to oscillate. Therefore, let me go into the wow on this. When something profound arises, you realize immediately, my mind is going to oscillate on this because of continuity fear. Continuity fear is the only problem that I have. I don't have any other problem. My mind's going to oscillate, therefore, full stop in the wow, right now. Be very determined. I am not going to follow the oscillations or choose sides at all. So what the false gurus say is, you must choose sides. You must take a side on this. You must choose. And then, so in order to not go into the negative oscillation, you you then become dependent on the guru and if you choose the positive oscillation, and the guru says, well, if you choose the negative, you're ignorant, you're bad, you've fallen into samsara and blah blah blah. So you have to choose the positive oscillation, and then the guru then becomes the means to choose the positive oscillation, and you become dependent on that, and then you become manipulated. You open yourself up to total manipulation. That's not the way. That's never the way. And there are such scoundrels like that, male and female. The cure for that is right spiritual practice, your own ability to wow what rises. So you're not following the oscillation. You're not taking pro or con. See, I certainly, as a Dharma prince, give you permission to practice the wow. Absolute permission. This, in any situation you're in, you have the right to practice this wow. I don't care what guru you're with, what teacher you're with, you have the right to stop at any moment and practice this wow. You're in control of your own path. You're the one who has the final say, so to speak. Now, of course, people also exploit these gurus, these scoundrels. It's a codependency thing. They think that they're going to get, won't have to do this difficult work of full stop and the wow. The guru will do it for them. So they say, I'm dependent on you, guru, and you had, then you have to do this, and for me, this sort of thing. So it's a trap for both. It's a trap for both. So they shouldn't. No one should say believe what I say. They should say wow what I say, wow what I say. In other words, don't agree with it and don't disagree with it. Detach from the oscillations, and just rest quietly. Be quiet. It's not about agreeing with what is said. It's about the shock of recognition, managing the shock of recognition. When the shock of recognition arises, as it will. That's just truth that is one in all of us. It's not the property of some guru or teacher at all. But those who do not know how to practice this way are in search of a guru. But the truth is that by practicing this way, the guru will find you, the real guru, the true gurus, the Dharma kings. They'll come to you. They'll find you, and they'll nod and say, here's somebody that knows how to practice. That means here is someone who's going to be truly successful. So I'm going to lend my authority and weight and protection to this one, because they're getting the job done. So don't go searching for a teacher or guru. Discipline yourself to practice properly, and then the heavyweight, the true gurus, they will come. They will introduce themselves to you. They're happy to introduce themselves to you. Here's somebody who truly knows how to practice properly. That's the key. The world is going into this mania, into this binging, and people will be desperately searching for gurus. And you better be careful about that. Yeah, we all do. Because it's a codependency sort of situation. All we do here is we train to practice properly. That's it. When we practice properly, the Dharma kings will show up in your life. When you learn to practice properly, the Dharma kings will show up in your life. I'm not a Dharma king. I'm just someone who's a student teacher, helps train how to practice properly. That's it. I'm nobody's guru. And the what will happen is that this binging, as the world goes into this binge mentality to try and stave off despair, and they'll go into a psychotic state of mind ultimately. first the binging, and they'll be looking for gurus and teachers everywhere. I need a guru, I need a teacher, I need a guru. In other words, they're going to try to get hold of the positivity and deny the negativity, the meaning, the continuity fear as it oscillates. Oh, that sounds great, but wait a minute, I think it's a threat, it's an abyss. Wait, this is the oscillation. Both of that, because of our continuity fear, arises together like it's just both there. And when we try to oscillate, that's when we get into this sort of feeling of split-mindedness. The negativity is over here, the positive is here. Don't try to grab a hold of it. Don't try to figure it out. Don't try to separate it out. What we really want is what we will choose, ultimately. But first we have to get familiar with it. That's the first step. You cannot avoid this step of familiarity. And this requires patience. So the Holy Spirit says, I say, you're going to ruin everything. So what am I doing? I'm just getting familiar with this notion. The Holy Spirit's going to ruin everything. I'm not assessing, am I for this or against it? What I'm for is familiarity with this likelihood. There's a very strong likelihood the Holy Spirit's going to ruin everything. It's going to ruin thingness for me entirely. Totally ruin thingness for me. So all I'm doing is I'm just getting familiar with this, that this is likely to happen. I'm not assessing, do I want this or do I not want this? It's unavoidable, really. It's unavoidable. So just the first step is just get familiar. This is going to happen. It's unavoidable. I recognize, oh, this is inescapable. Okay. First step always is familiarity. We always rest in familiarity, that this is what we're after. We're not after for acceptance or rejection of this. If something's unavoidable, why are we worrying about accepting or rejecting it? That's that kind of beside the point, isn't it? Embracing it or rejecting it? No. We don't need to embrace it. We don't need to reject it. It's going to happen. And so we just work on residing ourselves to that in terms of familiarity. This is going to be the new landscape. Okay, how do I get familiar with the new landscape? I must. It's an issue of familiarity entirely. The spiritual path is not an issue of positivity or negativity. It's an issue of familiarity. And that means it's a continuity fear issue entirely. Through and through and through. And this is the ultimate wisdom that we have to get to this and practice this. Otherwise, we will just continue to oscillate and flounder. We'll have manias, we'll have binges, we'll have psychoses and depressions and despair, and we'll just keep floundering on the beach, floundering around, you know, floundering around like the fish is floundering. Sometimes it flounders into shallow water. Other times it flops out onto the sand. Then it flounders back a little bit in the water, flounders. It's just floundering back and forth. And we just continue this floundering. That's it. It's all that happens in this world is just floundering, or we latch on to this familiarity issue. Continuity, fear, familiarity. This is the heart of the path. Forget about all the bells and whistles that are out there, the materialistic spirituality that's out there. Forget all that. It's not that important. The real gold in the world is to stop this floundering. And to realize the real issue is continuity, fear, and familiarity. So a pile of gold suddenly is in front of me. I said, well, you know, I'm neither for it nor against it. I know that I have a continuity fear. It will cause oscillation. So I'm just going to not detach from the oscillation and just call it a wow. I just sit here quietly in the wow, and I say it's a familiarity issue. That's the only issue there is. And just be determined to stay in that. Imagine a mountain of diamonds and gold in front of you, and all you're doing is you're doing nothing. This is the right spiritual discipline to have for everyone. For everyone. The realization is already within everyone. The truth is already within us. We just have to allow it to arise and get familiar with it. That's all we have to do. And people avoid this by all this fluff, you know, the spirituality, materialistic spirituality. They avoid practicing in this way. Click, oh, nice picture. Click, nice picture. Click, nice picture. Click, nice picture. I click, nice picture. But it's not practicing the wow. When you decide to not stop doing that, what happened? I said, okay, it's enough of that, enough Facebooking. Actually, Facebook was blocked for me yesterday. I tried to go to Facebook on Google, and I tried to type in Facebook.com, and a question mark, the question mark symbol would come up. And then I'd type a letter, F-A, immediately would take me to some query about that first letter I type. It kept looping back. It would open, you know, it opened some page on my computer, some file on my computer, F for file, question mark, F, file, and opened up, and I couldn't browse on the internet. I could not browse. I was at Google. I could go to YouTube because there's an icon I can click on, but Facebook, no icon. I could not go to Facebook. I could not. It was blocked for me. I was like, wow. So I restarted my computer in safe mode and then restarted again, and now I'm able to go there. But that was the Holy Spirit blocking it for me. Blocking it for me. Question mark. Is this really what you want to do? Not really. It's a great way to avoid practice. Now, if you're already able to practice, You can use it that way, but most there are not do not know how to practice full stop, and they're using it to avoid practicing. Because practicing isn't glamorous, isn't it? You're not Mr. and Mrs. Positivity, Miss Positivity, the Princess of Positivity, or the King of Positivity, or the Prince of Positivity. Everyone is going trying to be the Princess and Prince of Positivity. Of materialistic spirituality. He said, yeah, we can have our cake, we can have this lovely life here of material abundance, and we will, you know, light a nice candle and do some chanting, and just wonderful. So they avoid this practicing. They avoid it because the ego tells them to avoid it. You see, the ego, it can sponsor all this positivity. It does. It sponsors positivity in order to avoid this practice, full stop in the wow, because it knows that's the end of the ego. This practice works, and there's nothing the ego can do about it, except distract us so we don't do it. And it's not a difficult practice at all. The ego says, oh, it's so difficult. No, it's not difficult at all. It's just you decide that this is what I'm going to do, this is what I want to do, and then it's easy. It's easy. It's just determination, is all. You just use your will, determination. I'm not going to go there, is all you do. It's like a bowl of ice cream in front of you. I'm not going to eat it. How difficult is that? You're just not going to do it. You're not going to go there. It's called temptation, the temptation to try to latch on to positivity. You're just not going to go there. I mean, the Holy Spirit's going to ruin everything for us. So if you're latched on to positivity, you're going to feel that as a total threat. See, positivity is materialistic. What we advocate is super positivity. Super positivity. For super positivity, everything is ruined. Well, that's super positive. It's super positive. But this is not something, super positivity is something we have to get familiar with. It is not positivity. Positivity is materialistic. It's ego-based. It's based on time, space, process, and form. The belief in that, the dream of it. So all we do is just practice, full stop on the wow. This is the gold standard of practice. There's no higher practice. No higher practice. Because whatever practice we do that brings success, glimpsing of super positivity, it's leading to the Holy Spirit's going to ruin everything for us. Absolutely true. Totally ruin everything for us. No matter how we look at it, it's going to lead us to this wow necessity for the wow. Continuity fear is going to be involved. It absolutely is. We keep trying to think we can save some things. Some things can be saved. Somethingness can be saved. No, it cannot. The Holy Spirit will ruin everything for us. As Ananda Maima said to, I think, Gandhi, said, "I'm going to steal everything from you." He says, "What a thief you are. You've taken my disciples away from me. You've taken this away from me. Now you're going to leave me. You're just stealing everything. You're stealing all this stuff from me. You're a thief." And she laughs. He says, yes, I'm going to steal everything from you. And then he said, where can I find such a thief? Such a wonderful thief. This is the Holy Spirit speaking. Okay. I'm going to steal everything from you. I'm going to ruin everything for you. Ruin everything. So, from the positive standpoint, this is horrible, you see? So the positivists avoid this, thinking it's going to cast them down into some terrible negativity. You see how they're trapped? What a trap it is, right? They need some guru. I need a positivist guru. Help, positivist guru. Our guru-ess. There are many, many, many waiting in the wings. Many, many, many waiting in the wings. They've been schooling themselves on positivity. And they will be the New Age gurus. Because the New Age gurus come out of this terrible psychosis that the world's going to go into. This binging, this despair. As the structures fail them, despair arises, and then they try to binge to avoid it. And so they will flee into these cults, New Age cults. But people will think, this is good. This is finally, we got the right religion now. This is just like they say, finally, we got the right pope. You know, they're all these, those who are falling into psychosis are desperate. And they say, oh, finally, we got the right pope. There's hope for us. Maybe the New Age will happen. So these New Age gurus of positivity, those are the devils of egoic conceit. You don't want any age at all. You don't want a New Age. No, you don't. It's just a new style of positivity, just a new label for thingness, for time, space, process, and form, just attaching a different dress to it. Right? Same skeleton, different dress. And then say, we'll call it good. It's just how we transmigrate and go through cycles. This is just exactly how we do it. This is what we've always done. There's always a New Age around the bend. Always a New Age around the bend. So we're back in 1967 now. I saw this, I think some suburban or something had this big decal, said 67. I was praying for some help. 67. We're back in 1967. What was that? Summer of Love. What was that? When people started binging. As structure started collapsing. And then from there, the whole thing fell apart, actually. We did not know how to wow properly. And then from that point on, the next 50 years have been 77, 87, 97, 107. We're going up to now 17. So it's 50 years. The last 50 years have been hell. I mean, we're collapsing into global psychosis, actually. What we did is we went in search of Eastern religions and spiritual teachings, but we, for the positivity, we wanted a new style of positivity. That's not it. And then we glommed onto all these various teachers, most of whom were not legitimate teachers, actually. They were teachers of positivism. There were some legitimate ones. Ram Maharshi, for instance, entirely legitimate. Dharma King. Punjaji is not really controversial. I say he's legitimate, but those that came to him were looking for just some new style of positivity, and he said, you're not really after the truth. And so he told them, yeah, you're enlightened, go away and teach. And it was his way of getting rid of them, actually. That's what he said. Get rid of the leeches. But this is, but as far as his recognition, yeah, I mean, it would seem. But Brahmana is more the gold standard, okay. And Sri Sri Nandamayama is even, you might even say, beyond the gold standard. You lead me out of this. I'm not really someone that you should evaluate in terms of a guru. Is some sort of extreme boost. So we went in search of a new style of positivity. This, okay, was a great mistake, because we weren't ready to get down to business. The real business of the world. We're still into the business of affluence and making money and the good life. And how can we just be happy with this world? And so we're in search of someone who would say, you know, the art of living, how can you be happy living in the world? You can't be happy living in the world. It's not possible. You can only be happy when everything is ruined. Entirely ruined. But that's super happiness. You can't have your cake and eat it too. You can't have the world and be happy in the world. It's impossible. True happiness comes when we realize there is no world. There are no things. And that only will arise for you, and you'll experience it only when you have been able to wow this and get familiar with it. Get familiar. Familiarity is key. The continuity problem is the only problem I have. There is no other problem. And you might say, only familiarity, only full stop on the wow resolves the continuity problem. Familiarity is the only answer there is with this. And to get familiar, we have to glimpse it, and our mind will oscillate, for sure. So I glimpsed the Holy Spirit's going to ruin everything for me. What did I do? Okay, oscillation is coming. Let me go immediately into the wow. Let me not pursue this, chase after it, because then the oscillation is going to hit me, and I'm going to get thrown out of balance, and then I'm going to flee into the arms of some positivist, and then severe troubles will come. So all that I advocate is this full stop in the wild practice. Everything else will come from that. Naturally. Everything else will come naturally for this. Now, give me some credit where credit is due. The Zen Buddhists seem, some of Buddhism seems to, those who practice, seem to be practicing full stop in the wild to some extent. It's become a little bit institutionalized. So it's a real good teacher, though, can guide you in this practice. And so they're just, you know, they're not thinking any thoughts. They're not, but it's not that you're trying to not think any thoughts. It's you have to be aware of what is it you're doing. You're not going into the oscillation. It's there. You're not denying that it's there. So that there are these traditions, meditative traditions, that these traditions come from those who've been adept at full stop in the wow, and thus realization dawned upon them. That's where it comes from. But it can always just turn into a fixation, an institutionalized fixation. But that's why having those who are awake is very helpful, that they keep busting up this fixation and say, no, it's not just fixating, it's actually discipline to do it in the face of turmoil. Holy Spirit's going to ruin everything. That brings up turmoil within us, right? Do we identify? Do we wade into the turmoil? No, we just say, okay, there's turmoil. Okay. Wow. Don't assess it. Don't measure it. Don't analyze it. Don't plan to do something about it. Don't just do nothing about it. Okay, just do nothing about it. Except just wow it. Just wow it. Wow. And we're all so keen to get after positivism, our own happiness with things, that everyone says, "Well, I don't quite have time. Can you shorten it up for me? Put it in, you know, I got 10 minutes, 10 minute variation, and that's enough." As if it's a thing, as if it's a commodity, like there's an exchange here, a commodity exchange. We've gotten into materializing, turning everything into a commodity. This happened in the Renaissance ages. Everything got turned into a commodity severely. Capitalism began arising, and we're now in this materialistic mindset that we've completely lost sight of actual practicing. Practice is not a commodity. So I say we're in this materialistic age, which is a disaster. Mental illness waiting to happen. Now, ultimately, you get cured of mental illness by practicing the wow. That's how I got out of it. So everyone will be ultimately cured, but it's no fun at all, actually. If you think it's fun, you'll find out it's too much fun. Really. If you think weirdness is fun, you'll find out that mental illness is too much weirdness. You say, I thought I was having fun, but it's not so funny. It's not really, it's too much fun. What do I do? I don't know what I do. Full stop in the wow. Just don't turn your attention to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will immediately give you this scent, a faint scent at first, of liberation, and then you just wow it. Wow. There is a way out of this. Wow. Don't grab a hold of it. Don't accept it. Don't reject it. Just say, there is a way out of this. Wow. There is a way out of this. Wow. And just sit in this wow. Don't be eager, over-eager, or anxious, or desperate. Be intrepid, not desperate. So immediately when I turned to the Holy Spirit, I immediately became aware that I'm going to be liberated. Immediately. And then I immediately just wowed it. I said, wow. Okay. 1978. That's what happened. Immediately, I just wowed it. So somehow the wisdom is there right off the bat with the Holy Spirit that this is the right path to take. You just wow it. See, the Holy Spirit doesn't need our praise. Not like a guru. And I leave the Dharma Kings out of this because they're truly beyond any need for praise, etc. Absolutely they are. That's why they're trustworthy as encouragers of us and friends along the path, true friends. The Holy Spirit doesn't need any praise. So it immediately says, just wow it. Don't praise me. You know, don't do anything. You just wow this. You see, I am going to be liberated. There's no question about it. Absolutely true. I will be liberated from all possibility of any mental illness. I saw it right off the bat. Holy Spirit said, then gave me this somehow the wisdom to just, okay, just wow this. Just wow it. Wow. Imagine if you're in this terrible mental illness and you see no way out at all, and then suddenly you see, I'm going to be liberated from all of this suffering and misery. No doubt about it. How are you going to feel? Isn't that a huge wow? So accept the wow. Don't flounder in it. Embrace that. You won't flounder. When you embrace the wow, you don't flounder. That branch that fell, it's about 6 feet long. It's the size of a human body. And it suddenly fell off the left side of the tree. Oh my God. And the limb, I can see this whole limb is dying here on the left side of the tree. And it fell down. I have this blue foam floating mat for pools that's perfect to practice falling down dead on. I don't want to say I'm going to do it or not. If I say I'm going to do it, I get in my own way. I have these ideas for videos that are bubbling up, and I'm just wowing them. I say, that's really cool. I mean, all this coolness is bubbling up in me, but I don't rush into it. I just wow it. I said, if the Holy Spirit wants it to happen, it will happen. This tree limb just fell down dead on this dead mat. I mean, something is going to take a fall. Something's going to break off from the tree and fall dead from the left. This is what I'm concerned about. This will plunge the world into a psychosis. And really what I'm most worried about is people trying to latch onto me as a guru, which I am not. I'm a Dharma prince. That's a different thing. I can only advise them in practice, right? Practicing. The Holy Spirit's the guru. Only the Holy Spirit can liberate us from mental illness, totally liberate us. Only the grace of God can do this. So we have to get used to the grace of God helping us out, which it invariably does. Suddenly in our mind, just something will just bubble into our mind, like, oh my gosh, I'm just aware of this now. It just somehow like bubbles into our mind. That's the grace of God. That's the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit doesn't have any form. There's no form to grab a hold of, actually. This awareness bubbles into our mind, and then, wow, I'm now aware of this. What do I do? And then some practice will stop in the wow. But people go into the psychotic mode, which they certainly are very likely to, then everyone is in great danger of spiritual, who have spiritual wisdom, because people will try to fixate on you as representing what's positive. And then it's your job to protect them from the negative. Then there's no spiritual path at all at that point. And you just have this horrible special relationship. And a cult is what you have. It's not my job to protect anyone from the negative. What I'm saying is, don't worry about protecting yourself from the negative. Just go embrace the wow, your own meditation, your own discipline of wowing everything. Neither positive nor negative, but allowing familiarity to settle in. With the super positive. The super positive transcends this world. It transcends existence entirely, actually. So I don't know how to do it, because we'll just have to see what the Holy Spirit has in mind. I don't know if it's possible, you know, to advise, because they'll turn the advisor into some cult leader, you know, like that. The people have to get involved themselves into actually practicing in their own recognitions. There has to be the sangha, so to speak. It's very important, so it doesn't become a cult of positivity. So I just work for the Dharma King Longchenpa, and he knows how to set this up in the right way. So for me, it's the Dharma Kings are the teachers. If you want to glom onto something, they're the teachers. They can handle it. But it's guru. They say Buddha means Buddha, Dharma, Sangha, meaning the Dharma is the practicing right spirit, right practice, full stop, and the wow, and the Sangha is those who are doing this, helping one another. But when you're part of the Sangha, you're humble and you're not a teacher, so to speak. So you don't get into all these little cults. You're on the same level. Everyone's on the same level of we're practicing full stop on the wow, and that's it. It's very important. So Tibetan Buddhism did a very good job, has done a very good job at managing this properly. That's why Longchenpa is very important. Perhaps the highest Buddhist of them all, Longchenpa. He's certainly in that conversation. You say, well, who's the highest Buddhist? Well, Longchenpa is a name that nobody would disagree with when you say Longchenpa. You know, he's just, you know, top. Drawer, top echelon, up there at the pinnacle of wisdom, Buddha mind wisdom, as to how do you actually pragmatically help us out. And I'm just looking and seeing that are large institutions more helpful than all these small little things? Probably. I just saw that. Most people said, no, we got to get rid of these large institutions. Not necessarily. In fact, we may need even bigger ones. Because it's very important to have this those flattening out of those who are practicing, so they don't start getting into cults of positivity. They find somebody codependent, and then you're going to protect me. I'll have a special relationship with you. You're going to protect me from the negativity of this, the oscillation. And yes, I will protect you if you, you know, make me happy in this way. And you get into cults if you don't have this Buddha Dharma Sangha institution. So the ones who were enlightened set up these big institutions. They did it for a reason. So I'm not against that at all. You want a thriving institution. You don't want a fixated institution. So institutions, yes. Fixation, no. But you don't get free of the fixation by destroying the institution. Then you find yourself in some positivity cult, new age, yoga girl, yoga guy, positivity cult. And then you're just floundering. So Tibetan Buddhism has this tremendous love, honor, respect for the great gurus and the lineages, etc. Very important, meaning that they know that there's above them, there's some that really know the whole picture. Then they're transcendent of all samsara and suffering. And they're humble. And they do the practices. They know that they must practice. and you cannot form a special relationship with these great lamas except a practice relationship, and it's very demanding, full of discipline. This is the correct thing. Here, we just have all these positivity cults in materialism. That's not going to really help anyone out. And we've floundered over the last 50 years. We've floundered. But we shouldn't be wise enough now to realize what doesn't work. What doesn't work? And everyone is so against these big institutions. I'm not against them at all. They need to be cleaned up, and the fixations that are in them, or we need to, the ones that are not functioning properly anymore, can they be reformed? At this point, I don't know. This is the question that I'm not aware of the answer to this at this point. It's a great question to ask. Can Christianity be reformed? Or has it fallen so far? And can Buddhism be reformed? Honestly, I don't know which has fallen further, Buddhism or Christianity, actually. I mean, I looked at this Buddhist temple, this big complex, and on the bulletin board, I did a video on it. I haven't posted it yet because I'm not sure what to do with these videos. But there is nothing there about the Dharma at all. It's incredible. They have this large glass case with bulletin board notices, and every single one, I went over it, each one, and there was nothing there about the Dharma, the three jewels, nothing at all. It was completely materialistic, materialistic positivism, completely. And no one's ever there. They only come for some big food festivals, entertainment and food. It was all about, you know, potluck this, salmon dinner, bingo, I don't know, trips to Las Vegas, conference, women, Buddhist women conference, you know, the socially correct stuff. It was all just community, food, vacations, bonsai, gardening, all this kind of stuff. I call yoga girl stuff, you know, stuff that a aging housewife would be interested in, kind of thing. Suburban, bonsai and flower arrangements, bonsai, gardening. There wasn't a trace of the Dharma there, not even a trace. So, all these people who criticize Christianity, you know, you better look in the mirror. What shape is Buddhism in, actually? It's in terrible shape. This was, the Holy Spirit was showing me this. The Dharma King Longchenpa was showing me this. He says, go to this Buddhist temple here and see what you see. And I was just like, wow. And somebody tipped me off to this, that this in August they had this big Buddhist celebration to raise money and festival, big festival. And he was explaining to me what it was about. And everything he told me about, there wasn't a trace of the Dharma there at all. I said, oh yeah, it's so great. The food, the entertainment, it's a lot of fun. It's like a wonderful fair. And the kids love coming to it, you know. Kids love coming to it. Why? For all these, you know, kid distractions and food and fun and, you know, games and things like that. Yeah, it's great. And do you ever go any other time? Oh, no. It's just once a year we go to this festival. I was like, what? Isn't Buddhism about everyday practice? About the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha? Isn't that what it's about? Well, no, nobody has any idea about that anymore, really. Tibetan Buddhists are trying to keep it alive. But I'm sure they're aware, like, whoa. You know, the rest of the world, it's like a Titanic going down. I keep going back to this branch that fell down. Good Lord. That's so amazing. It would fall exactly on this. The mat is like 2.5 feet wide by about 6 feet long. Maybe 6.5 feet long. It fell exactly on the middle of this mat that I've been using to fall down dead on. So something's going to fall down dead pretty soon from the left. And this is trouble, as I told you. This is trouble. It's trouble for everyone. It's trouble for me. Maybe the Holy Spirit's telling me to keep a very low profile right now. Very low profile. Just go skateboarding. I'm going to go skateboarding today. It just, the opportunity just suddenly arose. People have been telling me, you got to go this place. You got to go. You got to go. I was like, wow, really? And so many different influences have been telling me this. It's amazing. And now suddenly there's an opportunity to go up and go up in that, up there. And I said, wow, okay, I've got to go. And just, you know, I'm just wowing it. Just wow, all I can do. Am I nervous? Am I this, that? No, I just wow. Just stay in the wow. Just stay, when you're in the wow, you don't get too nervous. You don't get too positive, up or down. Now you're maybe not that much fun to be with. Well, that's what they're looking for, gurus who are fun. People want to, they try to avoid the despair by having fun. So you go to the Buddhist festival to have fun. And that's how they, now that they have, how they help you avoid despair. You go to Christian services to have fun. Let's sing and dance and shout, or let's do whatever we do and have fun. Bingo. By the way, folks, bingo every, you know, Saturday here. And when we go to Catholic Church, we now the Hispanics are setting up a huge food market outside. When you leave the church, they have all these food booths cooking tacos and all this Mexican food. And they say, after service, be sure to have some good Mexican food as you go outside. So it's becoming a festival, carnival. And actually, some of the priests are commenting on that. They said, actually, one of the priests, the one that I say is very keen, very wise, young, he actually criticized the Hispanics. He says, you know, they don't pay any attention to, you know, what's going on. It's what is this? He says, what is this? I don't understand their style of Catholicism. He really said that. I don't understand it. It's like a festival. Carnival and a festival. Are they here? What are they here for? So he probably, he does Hispanic Mass, actually. He's trying to guide them properly, but good luck with that. Good luck with that. They're into materialism, very much so. Not all. Just like the same with any group, right? But this is the heart of the church. The third world peoples are the heart of the Catholic Church now. The most, you know, more middle class and upper class people have abandoned the church. So this is a disaster for the church. Well, you have this carnival-like mindset, festival. Like, church is there to throw festivals for us so we can have fun to drive the despair away. That's the opposite of what the church institution is all about. It's the opposite. They're supposed to teach you right spiritual practice, which is this full stop in the wow. Then they teach you discipline. And it's the same for any pagan group. We're all pagans until we learn right spiritual practice. We are all pagans until we learn right spiritual practice. We're all heathen until we learn right spiritual practice. I didn't say capitalism is right spiritual practice. We've gotten into this thing of thinking that you're a heathen until you learn capitalism or socialism. One of the two, basically. Communism. You're a heathen until you learn this advanced way of society. No, that's not the definition of how to get free of heathenism. We're heathens and pagans until we learn right spiritual practice. So I'm no longer a pagan or a heathen, because I know right spiritual practice. That's why Longchenpa made me a Dharma prince. He says, you know right spiritual practice. Plain and simple. He says, I'm telling you that you know it. So the guru has to be the one that tells you that you are no longer a pagan. You're no longer a heathen. And when you're not, then you're a Dharma prince. You're a prince or a princess. Totally different story. You're not a capitalist or a communist or a socialist. You're a Dharma prince or princess. A Dharma, meaning the truth. The truth. So Longchenpa has made me a Dharma prince. He said, this is what you really are if you want to accept this. This is what you now are because you know how to practice properly. And that's a the greatest skill in the world. Doing a triple kickflip on a skateboard is not the greatest skill in the world. Okay, knowing how to do right spiritual practice is the greatest skill in the world. So I didn't make myself a Dharma prince. Longchenpa did. And so I had to make sure that he was someone who would know this, truly know whether this is accurate. Is he being accurate or not? So I had to assess, well, someone says I'm a Dharma prince, well, is he capable of making this clear assessment or not? And he is. But I had to determine that. I'm not going to rush in to say, oh, you know, because these false gurus, they love saying, okay, you're now, you know, you're this, now you're now this. Oh, that's so positive, that's wonderful. But they're just, that's the dance of this codependent cult thing. Try to avoid despair, dance of positivity. So I had to say, well, you know, you say that, okay, let me see what I say about you. Are you a true Dharma king or not? He's not afraid of the scrutiny. So only the Dharma kings can tell you whether you're practicing correctly or not. Whether you know right spiritual practice or not. And whether you're good at it or not. I've been doing it for, you know, 39 years, but probably my whole life. But you can say when the Holy Spirit, I really turned to the Holy Spirit, that's when it started. I saw I would be liberated from all mental illness, entirely, all mental troubles. And then wowed that. So that was the start. So it's been... pretty soon I'll be starting on my 40th year of practicing this. Wow. So, Longchenpa is saying, you're a Dharma prince, meaning you're good at it. You're very good at it. Very accomplished. And so this is how the institutions work. You have, at the top you have the grace of God. Then you have the Dharma kings. Whichever institution you want to call it, the ones who are adamantly free and no possibility of them ever falling back again, no possibility. They know what it's all about. Then, under them, you have the Dharma princes and princesses, however you want to call it. Just call it Dharma prince. I don't want to get into this he, she sort of thing. Dharma prince. Because one who knows how to practice properly knows they're not a body, they're not a gender, etc., etc. So we just have to settle on just one nominative, gender-neutral nominative. And throughout history, it's been the he. I've examined this, and it's legitimate. The reasoning behind it is very valid and accurate, actually. So we're just going to... If whether you have a female body or male body, you could just say, if a guru says you're a Dharma prince, you're a Dharma prince. Plain and simple. We don't need to make some different... This is an illness, sickness of the world right now. It's pulling us down into materialistic positivism. Is this he, she? It's a disaster. It's a sign of a great decay and collapse. When I say Dharma prince, I'm not thinking like I'm a male or anything. No, that never crosses my mind. I've gone over this in innumerable videos, so I just don't need to go over it now. Either people get it or they don't. We don't need to get into this gender wars. It's settled, okay? We just use the neutral nominative. We say God, he. We just say he. And that's, for here, it's settled. We're not going to put up some institution trying to cater to positivism here, Okay? It's not about that. It's about wowing. In the last 50 years, what have we done? We've ignored our spiritual practice and instead been going through all these gender wars and feminism and all this of, we need to change the language. We need to change this. We need to change this. That's the problem. No, it's not. That's never the problem. Because nature, this dynamic we've set up to drive us all into despair, to try to change who we are, extremely favors the female aspect of nature as the aspect that keeps producing bodies, meaning keep producing the form of despair. That we cannot, using the female nominative, automatically tilts everything into a presumption of positivity instead of super positivity. So you simply, because nature gives females such an advantage over males, you cannot then give the advantage of labeling everything God is she and the goddess. The goddess is the goddess of despair, actually. Form, time, space, process, and form has to have tremendous bias towards the feminine, towards female. And it does. So you cannot bring that bias into the means to get free of it in terms of the language, using she for all this stuff. That won't work. It won't work. And we're seeing what happens when we go in that direction. You're going to collapse into a global psychosis is what's coming, which is what you call the New Age. It's really, the New Age is just global psychosis of materialistic positivism. Meet the New Age, same as the Old Age. Pete Townsend, The Who. They were poets. They were poets. I mean, these musicians were court jester poets, kind of, really, in the 60s. Meet the new boss, same as the old boss. We won't get fooled again, yeah. Well, we almost got fooled again. Right? But we're waking up to this whole thing. So we use the male nominative. Guess what? Settled. You don't have to worry about that. Guess what you can do now? You get to practice. You get to practice. And you stop this ridiculous crusades. All these ridiculous crusades. That, yeah, as soon as this crusade is successful, I'll practice. Too late. You know, too late. You've already collapsed into psychosis. You cannot afford any crusades. You must practice, full stop, in the wow. You don't have the luxury for crusades, okay? Nobody does. We spent the last 50 years crusading, and we're ready to collapse now. Congratulations, everyone. We don't ascend into the New Age. We collapse into the New Age. And of course, we label it new. New's always better, right? This is marketing. We've just marketed this collapse to ourselves by calling it New Age, the New Age. We think that everything that's new is better. We have this automatic assumption. It's new. Do we not? And I saw this guy with this old Ford Bronco. And I said, who's Bronco? I said, it's mine. I say, wow. It's very retro. It's very cool. He says, yeah, it's completely stripped down. There's nothing in it. I mean, it's completely stripped. I said, well, there's very little that can go wrong. Nothing that can go wrong. He says, yeah, that's right. I said, wow, I like that. There's you know, no radio, no AC, no this, no that. It just really stripped to the bare bones. He says, but it works great. He says, the engine's great. The engine transmission is just great. I said, holy cow, man. I really like that. That is really cool. That's very full stop in the wowish, isn't it? But we assume that everything that's new is better. New car, new this. Oh, it must be better. It must solve my despair with what I have now. But actually, you start noticing, people tell me all the time, actually, this is better. That what I had before was better. I'm starting to realize what I had before was better, actually. So what's going on here? Like the weather forecasts are so off these days. Used to be way better than it is now. And then you start realizing some of the stuff I used to have was way better than what they have now. Is new always mean better? But we have, it's the vulnerability we have that new means better. We think it's fresh, it must be better. But all the complexity that engineers are building into everything, is at some point that we say, wait a minute, this car's too complex for me. I don't like driving a car with all this massive complexity. I got into this Honda that had all the bells and whistles. It was you know, the top of the line with all the options. And I got into it and I said, I don't want to drive this. This is terrible. This isn't better. This is worse. You have too many options. At what point do you get to too many options? Isn't that worse? Isn't that worse? If you have too many options, isn't that worse? Has things gotten better or worse? And the engineers say there's no such thing as too many options. Well, you know, they're dead wrong about that. Man, that tree branch, that is just, it's impossible to ignore. Too many options. You can shift this way, you can shift this way, you can choose this thing, you can choose this cruise control, this cruise control, this option. So you're driving and you got mirrors here, cameras here, cameras here, cameras here. You know what I want? I just want a car that you can look out the rear window and the side windows, and guess what? You have visibility. Like the Dodge Caravan. I love the Dodge Caravan. You could see where all the cars are. Isn't that an amazing concept? I'm driving along, and I'm up there, and I can see behind me to the side. I see everything. I said, my God, that is so wonderful. And you've got a car now. You can't backing up. You have to look at the backup mirror, the backup camera. You can't. Otherwise, you can't back up. Most cars are that way now. It's terrible. I hate it. And there's a camera when you click, it shows you what's on the right. You know, that's a total distraction. So more options, features, all this stuff, is more distractions. More distractions. At what point do you have too many distractions and it gets in the way of your experiencing, it gets in the way of your calm, it gets in the way of the quality of what you're doing? Too many features. For the engineers, there's no such thing. It's too many features. More features, more features. That's what we do. We design features. And we got, well, you know, put them on an island and let them, you know, work with some rocks and build rock formations or something. I don't know. We don't need them producing more and more features. Like for here, I just have this webcam and, you know, post to YouTube. That's it. I don't need any more features. Occasionally you throw some bells and whistles, but just water. Let's just get back to drinking water, in other words. Just the clear truth. Let's just get back to water. Get rid of all these bells and whistles. We don't need them. The institutions, great institutions, preached austerity, discipline, humility. Austerity, discipline, humility. And could they overdo it? Yeah. But the overdoing it is because they're trying to avoid practicing. People who come into this, they say, I don't want to practice the wow. So let me practice being super austerity, which Buddha said, no, that's not it. Don't fixate on austerity. Don't fixate on discipline. Don't fixate on humility. Those are all there. But practice, right practice, is where it's at. Full stop in the wow. The middle path means practicing, not identifying with this oscillation. Really, the whole Buddha's middle path thing is just full stop in the wow. That's all that it really is. That's what he was saying. Don't don't fixate on either positive or negative of the oscillation, try to do anything about it. Familiarity. Middle path is familiarity. And we've tried to spiritualize throughout history, and so we've lost sight of it. We've lost sight of the simplicity of full stop and the wow. That's the heart of all religious institutions. That's what the purpose of them is, actually, is just full stop and the wow. Practicing this with, as you go through these, the bubbles in your mind of glimpsing truth, reality. Oh my gosh, that's what it, wow, wow. Neither affirm it nor negate it. Just get used to it. Neither affirm it nor negate it. Just get used to it. Neither affirm it nor negate it. Just get used to it. So these great... Well, what do we do now? I don't know. It's... We will see. We will see what the Dharma Kings do and the Holy Spirit does. Okay. I still have a little... that branch falling. That worries me. Well, we're talking... We're talking about what to do. Full stop on the wow. Now, can Dharma princes lead some into... the institution, the greater institution, the three jewels, in other words, the greater institution. Could I recommend people going to Catholic Church? No, I cannot recommend it. Can I recommend them going to Protestant Church? No, I cannot. Can I recommend them going to a Buddhist? I've been looking for Buddhist temples and places to go. I can't find any, tell you the truth. I looked at all the Buddhist temples in Los Angeles, for instance, meditation centers. It's so... positivist, materialistic positivism. I just said, no, I wouldn't go there. I wouldn't tell anyone to go there. I literally don't know any place that I can tell someone to go to at this point. So we may just have to do it on the street. You know, it may be street preaching is what we have to turn to. And this then will gradually help loop us into perhaps another realm, perhaps another place, a reduced intensity zone, where there's this great institution there. We can set up this great institution. That's way better. This helps everyone focus on practice instead of some positivist relationship. Instead of a cult, like setting up all these little cults, the world could very well fragment into many, 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 many little positivist cults, super number of cult leaders. I'm not into that. I see that institutions, there's a reason why we've had them, and it's claimed in the New Age we won't have that. We'll get rid of these institutions, and what folly is that. It's no, there's a new way of doing it, new thing, and everybody's capable of just doing their thing and doing. Really? Is that how it really works? Or is this just the ego's kingdom, the ego calling it the New Age as a marketing ploy, so we think that new is better, and we'll get trapped into that. Now the cars used to be better than they are now. In a lot of ways. Sure, they've made them drive better and handle better and all this kind of stuff. They've tweaked the engine stuff. But as far as the experiencing of driving, it used to be way better than it is now. Way better. Way, way, way better. But nobody went as fast, for instance. People weren't maneuvering like this and causing, you know, like freak out. I'm going to accidents.